When people talk about thin film based solar cells, they become very comfortable or very accustomed to representing these different layers which go into these thin film solar cells by this kind of a box, and then representing each layer by drawing a line. For example, over here is this cadmium terrylite based solar cell, and in this diagram I have represented the different layers. For example, glass, then this TCO layer, then the cad sulfide n-type contact layer, then the cadmium terrylite layer. It's all the different layers which make up this solar cell by using, you know, these lines to distinguish between them. Similarly, over here on this side, I have this a micromorph cell, which is a tandem cell made up of amorphous silicon and microcrystalline silicon. So over here, the way it's drawn is the light is coming from the bottom, and you have glass over here, then this tin oxide TCO, then amorphous silicon, which has a higher band gap, which has a band gap of approximately 1.7, and then microcrystalline silicon below it. So, you know, people are very comfortable when you talk to them about solar cells by drawing them or depicting them this way. But what is missing in this diagram is that these thin films are essentially polycrystalline or multicrystalline or amorphous materials, and penetrating inside these cells, or you know, inside these cells, there's a huge density of these grain and these grain boundaries which are essentially running throughout the cell. So essentially there will be grain boundaries which are, you know, traversing like this inside the cell, and this is never depicted whenever you draw these diagrams of these thin film technologies. But a very quick SEM picture taken of any of these cells reveals these grains and these grain boundaries in all its glory. So shown here are again those same cells. This is the same cadmium terrylite cell, and this is the cell which is a tandem between amorphous silicon and microcrystalline. But now you get you know, a very good sense of how the grain and the grain boundaries are penetrating throughout the cell. So you can see that, you know, there are these plethora of grain boundaries which are essentially running throughout the cross section of this cell. Similarly, over here you see this very, very large density of essentially grain boundaries, these stacking faults, and you know, all these other things which are running through this cell. So one might wonder, you know, looking at this picture, that how does even this cell, you know, produce any electricity, or you know, how does it convert, or it's able to extract any of these electron and hole pairs? But, you know, one, in the situation is not as bad, you know, as dire as one might presume by looking at this picture. And these cells do operate and, you know, deliver decent efficiencies such that they're used commercially. And one of the reasons why this is even possible is because this transport is essentially parallel to the direction of the grain boundaries. And here's what I mean by it. So assume that this is my thin film based solar cell, and these yellow lines are essentially, you know, the grain boundaries which are running throughout the cell, and this is the direction of the grain boundaries. Now the way this solar cell works is that this electric field is essentially in this direction. So, you know, I have my emitter contact over here, and then my current is essentially, or you know, my electrons and holes, they're being collected, or they're flowing in this particular direction. And this direction is, if you can see over here, it lies parallel to the direction of most of these grain boundaries. So if I generated the electron and hole pair, and it gets collected at this contact over here, it might not encounter this grain, or you know, it might not encounter this recombination due to the grain boundary at all, because the grain is essentially running parallel to this direction of this current flow. Versus if my cell was in you know, of such a kind such that I had my contacts placed over here. So let's say I had my n-type and p-type contact placed over here, and I was collecting my electron and holes in this, along in this direction, which is perpendicular to my grain boundaries. So there's a very large chance that, this electron might recombine when it traverses through this grain boundary. Maybe it missed out on this one. Maybe this grain boundary missed out, but it will soon encounter another grain boundary, and it's very likely that it will get recombined before it gets collected. So one of the reasons why these grain boundaries are they are still a major concern, but they could be even a bigger concern if the current flow direction was like this. But since the flow of the current and the flow of this electric field is parallel to the grain boundary, it helps in alleviating some of the impact of these grains. So that brings me to the next thing I want to talk about, that is, how does these grain boundaries affect the performance of the cell? And I have essentially drawn this diagram over here. So let me consider the case where I have just one grain boundary in my whole solar cell, and I want to figure out, how essentially it will affect the device performance. So this grain boundary, essentially, it means that I'll have a higher recombination over here. Now I can, represent this thing by a distributed model. So, I can depict this situation by this these distributed set of diodes. So, I've taken a 2D cross section of this cell, and I have each of these small regions. I'm depicting them as a diode. So this is a diode. It's forward biased, and it's conducting current in this direction. So one might wonder, if it's forward biased, how it's conducting the current in this direction. But you can easily recall that's how a solar cell works. So you have a voltage which is positive, and you have a current flow in the opposite direction. So this would be the IV characteristics of the cell. So I'll have this is my VOC. This is my short circuit current over here, and I'm operating in, let me use the same color. Let me use blue for my axis. So I'm operating in this region where essentially I'm applying a positive voltage, and I'm getting a current in this direction, and that's how I'm generating power. Now essentially I can represent the region which is affected by this grain boundary. So this grain boundary, maybe it ran through this region, and this region, is the spoiled orange among these different diodes, and it essentially will have a very high recombination because all the electrons and holes which essentially come to this grain boundary can very quickly recombine. So the IV characteristics of this rotten cell, or this bad cell which is affected due to these grain boundaries, would be essentially, it would have a much lower open circuit voltage because I have a lot more recombination. More recombination means reduced open circuit voltage. So its open circuit voltage will reduce, and also its current, or its short circuit current, will also reduce because essentially now a lot of these electron and hole, they recombine before they are collected out. So this, for this bad cell, which essentially represents the region through which my grain boundary passes, I can represent its IV characteristics by, essentially like this, where I have a reduced VOC. So let me call this VOC 1 and GSC 1. So I have, instead I get VOC 2, which is lower, and also a short circuit current, which is much lower. So now, how does this affect, the rest of the cell? So if you think about the rest of these cells, which are connected in parallel to the cell, so they all want to operate at this high open circuit voltage, and they want to operate at this high short circuit, they want to supply this high short circuit current. But this diode, this essentially cannot deliver current in that region. So now, since all these cells, the good ones and the rotten one, they're all connected in parallel, they have to operate at essentially the same voltage. So the only way this rotten diode can support this higher operating voltage, let's say all the other cells, they operate at this voltage where they all essentially generate power. Now, the only way this other bad cell, which has lower VOC, it can support that same open circuit voltage is by going into this regime where it's not generate, where it's forward biased. What it's doing now is that the current flow in this rotten cell is essentially reversed. So the current is now flowing in this direction. And that current is being supplied by all these other cells which are in the vicinity of these rotten cells. So are these good cells which are in the vicinity of these rotten cells. They're essentially supplying this current, which is now getting sinked into this rotten cell. So in effect, what has happened is that because of this grain boundary, essentially all these diodes which are all the regions which is present in the vicinity of this grain boundary is essentially, not contributing to my solar cell operation, but in fact all the current which is being generated over here is getting recombined into this grain boundary. And it can be shown that the number of these diodes affected. So, I can say the length of this region which gets affected due to this bad diode, or this region which will get affected, is essentially this ratio of the length or the number of the diodes which are affected. It's essentially depends on a lot of things, depends upon the sheet resistance of the semiconductor and so on. But it can be shown that it's approximately proportional to the exponential of the difference between the good cell, the exponential of the difference in the voltage, open circuit voltage between the good cell and the bad cell. So if I have a very severe grain boundary and I have very high recombination of this grain boundary, this VOC is essentially very reduced. This VOC2 is very low. So it will affect a much larger area around this grain boundary. So even this one grain is essentially it's creating this sink, which can the effect is very similar to having this small hole. So you have a boat which is filled with water, but a small hole can essentially affect a lot of region, and it can drain out the water from a large region. So a grain boundary essentially behaves in the same way. And the more severe the recombination in this grain boundary is, the lower is the VOC for that particular area, and higher is the region that it affects around it. So in general, we want to avoid having grain boundaries, and we want to essentially, even if we have grain boundaries, we want to try to passivate them such that the recombination over there is not that severe.